At the very moment he was being denounced as a traitor, Captain Terence O'Neil, the Prime Minister, was spending the day calmly at his country house. There, for the past 12 years, the ex-Guards officer has passed his spare time planting trees. His performance is very cool.
Fraught is rather one of my pride and joys.
Do you find the tension of the present crisis something which gets you down, or do you enjoy it?
No. Harold Wilson once said to me that he could always sleep whatever happened. And I think I can almost say that as well, and I think it is an advantage. I think people who cannot sleep when there is tension about in the air, I think do suffer. But I'm very fortunate. I've never had a sleeping pill in my life, and I never intend to have one.
Another of the Prime Minister's hobbies is collecting Victorian porcelain figurines. Many of them are now valuable. Among them, I saw Mr. Gladstone and asked if that prophet of Irish Home Rule could be one of his heroes.
One of your political heroes?
No, he's not a political hero in the north of Ireland. He was really made as a pair to Disraeli further down there.
Who are your political heroes? Who are the politicians you most admire?
I think Disraeli probably is a political hero, really, so far as I'm concerned. We have his portrait in the cabinet room, which I borrowed from the portrait gallery in London.
I saw that this morning, yes.
And he was originally in number 11 Downing Street when Reggie Maudling was there, and then I believe when Jim Callaghan came out, the Tory Chancellor was chucked out, and I picked him up.
Well, what is it about Disraeli, what are the qualities in him that you like?
I think he managed to transform completely the Tory party of that day, and I think for that we should remember him. In fact, there mightn't be a Conservative party today if it hadn't been for Disraeli's work 100 years ago.
Well, do you see an analogy between Disraeli transforming his Tory party and the transformation that's taking place in your party here?
Well, perhaps it would not be not for me to say that kind of thing, but certainly I do admire the work he's done.
What is your view of the Reverend Paisley?
Well, he, of course, could not exist in any other part of the United Kingdom. He would be laughed out of court in any other part of the United Kingdom. This is his big tragedy. I often think, don't you, that people with a certain amount of ability have chips on their shoulders which they've gathered in their youth. They can't get rid of them, and they get into a mold, into a groove, into a policy from which they cannot retreat, however idiotic that policy may be. I would say that this is his problem.
In the very grand cabinet room at Stormont Castle, I asked the Prime Minister why he had gone into politics.
Well, to some extent, because it was a family tradition, and nobody in my generation was doing it at the time, and I've always been extremely interested in politics. I would, in actual fact, rather have gone to Westminster, and indeed I tried to go there, but was not able to manage it, and I came here instead.
Why would you prefer to go to Westminster?
Well, I suppose the subjects which you discuss at Westminster are on rather a wider front than the provincial problems with which we are faced here. And I think, obviously, it's a larger forum, but now that I'm here, I'm here.
This divided land may be small. Its politics are bitter and convoluted. A country of only 1.5 million people, nevertheless, has the trappings of a great state. Nearly 50 years ago, Lord Carson's ferocious spirit helped create Ulster as a Protestant-dominated state. The hall of an Orange Lodge in County Derry. The Protestant rank and file are nervous of any gesture towards the Catholics. Here, the grassroots members of the party were anti-O'Neill. For them, the issues were the old ones. No surrender.
There has been, in the past, amongst us, an absolute unity of purpose. And there must continue in the future, amongst us unionists, unity of purpose. And this cannot be achieved by anyone trying to split the Protestant and Unionist ranks. Anyone who decides that only the half of the Protestant people in Northern Ireland, or maybe less than half of them, are fit to be called Unionists and would seek to boost them up with questionable enough Roman Catholics to make a Unionist party is no good to Ulster. This middle-of-the-road idea...
The meeting had gathered to hear William Craig, former Minister for Home Affairs, a focal point for opposition to the Prime Minister. Mr. Craig was sacked in December from the government. He is the new hero of the lodges.
The Protestant people are united within the Orange Order and within the Unionist Party, and this is the kind of unity that we need and no other. Unity of purpose for the future welfare of Ulster. Unity of purpose to carry out the kind of policy that has been put before you tonight by Mr. Craig, who is one of the best protagonists of this future policy of Ulster that I have heard.
William Craig was asked by Lew Gardner what the real differences between him and the Prime Minister were.
There's very little disagreement. I disagree with him in the appointment of the commission. That really is the only item of commission, or item of policy that I disagree with. I disagree with his lack of strength. He seems to blow with every wind of pressure that's applied to him, and consequently no one is ever sure that he will carry his policies through.
Do you accept, Mr. Craig, that whoever is going to be Prime Minister, that there will have to be sooner or later some fundamental changes towards the minority vote in this country?
The minority in this country have always got an absolutely fair and square deal. And this is where O'Neil has gone wrong in an effort to project himself as liberal. He has been apologizing for the past. He has refused to recognize the facts of the past and the present situation. There is no need to make any change in Unionist policies in the sense that you've got to be fair to a minority section. The policies always have been absolutely fair. Indeed, as you move around the country now, O'Neill is being likened to de Gaulle, having little or no regard to his party or to the feelings in the country at large. That he is the one that can see the right way, and anyone who disputes it with him is a reactionary living in the past, an extremist of some sort or other.
Is the conflict between them merely a struggle for power within the Unionist Party?
This is difficult to assess, isn't it? So far as Mr. Craig is concerned, when he first came into the administration, he was a very forward-looking young man and did a lot of good work. I think he's changed. For what reason? I do not know.
Did you have it in mind always to carry out liberal policies, or is it something that's come to you later in life?
Well, first of all, you've got to find out what the problems are, and once you've discovered what they are, then you've got to decide what you think you can manage to do in the circumstances, bearing in mind, of course, that politics is the art of the possible. And having assessed the situation, then you must decide what reforms you believe should be carried out. And because of the nature of politics in Northern Ireland, there does tend to be a resistance to reforms which doesn't operate at Westminster.
Why do you think politics in Ulster have the characteristics you're describing?
Well, of course, Ulster was born in a difficult situation. She has tended to have, as I have said in some of my speeches, a fortress mentality. And as a result of that, under the slogan of no surrender, it's rather inevitable that you can drift on from no surrender to no reform.
One of the fears expressed by your opponents, Captain O'Neil, is that by giving more power to the Catholics, you are leading eventually to a policy of a united Ireland which would be ruled by Catholics.
Well, of course, this is completely and absolutely idiotic. I am totally dedicated to the United Kingdom. But I believe that Ulster cannot survive unless the Unionist policy is supported by the minority. Let us just for a moment consider the figures involved. More than 50% of all the children at school today in Northern Ireland are Roman Catholic. If we cannot make them feel that Ulster is their home, if we cannot make them feel like we do, that the United Kingdom is the right place for them to be in, then there cannot be any long-term future for Northern Ireland. In fact, if I could summarize it, my critics are the people who want to maintain Ulster for today and yesterday, that I want to maintain Ulster as an integral part of the United Kingdom for tomorrow.
At a hotel at Portadown on Monday, the Unionist Protestant crisis approached its climax. Snow appropriately decorating the winter of the party's discontent. Here gathered 9 of the 12 dissident MPs to discuss what policy to pursue towards Captain O'Neill. They hoped to force a party meeting at which a new leader would be elected. They issued a statement calling for a party meeting on Wednesday. No one knew who the new compromise candidate might be. One major dissident, Brian Faulkner, did not go to that meeting. While it went on, he talked to Lew Gardner. He is the most likely compromise candidate, having just resigned as Deputy Prime Minister.
At the moment, I'm bound to say that it looks quite clear that Captain O'Neill has lost the confidence of the party. You couldn't have a parliamentary party with 12 people prepared to sign a document asking for a change of leadership and still claim that the man who's currently the leader had the support of the party. A man must have a much stronger hold upon a party than that.
Are you a candidate for the post of Prime Minister?
No, quite certainly not. And I have made it very clear in public and in private that I am prepared to serve under any leader who has the united support of the Unionist Party and who, and this is of vital importance, is prepared to carry out each and every one of the policies which are the policies of the O'Neill government.
You're prepared to serve. Are you also prepared to be drafted?
That's quite another question, you know, and that's such a hypothetical question that no one can answer it until it arises. Can I make it absolutely clear that I am not seeking office in any way, and let's make it further clear, I see absolutely no sign of a draft.
One hears Captain O'Neill referred to by his opponents as a sort of de Gaulle-like figure. Did you see this kind of image growing about him in his years of office?
He's certainly a very determined man, and de Gaulle is, I gather, somewhat determined. But de Gaulle is very much a presidential figure, and I would hope that there's no danger of Captain O'Neill trying to develop that kind of cult. This would be most unhealthy.
You know him, you've worked with him as a colleague. What do you think is running through his mind at the moment? How's it working?
I'm no mind reader, but I must say this, that Captain O'Neill is certainly a very good fighter. He always fights his corner. I'm sure that's what he's thinking about at the present time.
At the same time as the rebels met at Portadown that Monday, the Prime Minister called a crisis meeting of his cabinet at Stormont Castle. The battle was joined. What would Captain O'Neill do? Could he save his party? Could he save his policies? The cabinet meeting lasted 8 hours, but at last they made their decision. There would be a general election on the 24th of February. The meeting with the rebels would not take place.
There's been some criticism that you didn't go and meet the dissidents and that the matter was not put to a vote of the whole party. What is your view of that?
We've had so many party meetings, of various kinds in the party. At the last one, instead of the usual kind of vote of a kind of omnibus character in favour of the government, I personally insisted that it should be a personal vote in my leadership. That meeting was very recent, and by an overwhelming majority, I got a personal vote. That should satisfy most people in ordinary circumstances. And as it hasn't done, we must now put these grave matters to the proof and go to the country.
Immediately after this sensational decision, Lew Gardner talked again to William Craig and asked him if the dissidents' problem was that no leader had emerged.
Well, the parliamentary party meeting was cancelled by the Prime Minister. I am pretty sure that if we had met, someone would have emerged.
And do you think?
I think he didn't call the meeting because he knew a change would come.
And really, after February 25th or February 24th, we'll be back to square one.
We will be meeting again to decide who the leader will be.
Will that leader be Captain O'Neill?
You asked me that on February 27th.
If you are successful in the election, it is still feasible that some of the dissidents will return to Parliament and that they would argue the political situation essentially is unchanged. How would you see it as changing?
Well, of course, this is imponderable, isn't it, until after the result of the election is published. But I would doubt very much indeed whether we will have the same Parliament as we have today. I would prefer to have, at Stormont, a Unionist party which was forward-looking, rather than one which was swept in on the coattails of a forward-looking government, when, in fact, some of them didn't approve of the policies which they had adumbrated at the election. I think it may be that in this election, the members of the Unionist Party will be more homogeneous when they return here. What the numerical result will be, I don't know. But it may be that we will have quality this time instead of an excessive quantity.
Among these constituency party members, Mr. Craig was wildly received. One of Captain O'Neill's problems is that it's the constituency parties which nominate Unionist candidates. At the moment, the signs are that most of the rebels will get an official nomination.
The Prime Minister, without waiting for the proper democratic decision of the parliamentary party, has called an election. Indeed, if one wants to attach the adjective of rebel to anyone in the Unionist movement, it is to he, because it is he who makes it.
Can you envisage a state of affairs in which perhaps Mr. Craig or Mr. Faulkner would return to the cabinet?
Well, I never like to look ahead too far. Mr. Craig had to be dismissed from the cabinet because of his utterances and because he held a job of great responsibility where he was on the one hand appealing for calm and on the other making inflammatory speeches. And Mr. Faulkner left of his own free will.
Are you going to the country leading the Unionist Party or thinking of forming a new party?
No, we are going to the country at the head of the Unionist Party. Any splinter groups which may have hived themselves off, well, that, of course, is a matter for themselves. But the cabinet here are going to the country leading the Unionist Party.
Is there a sense in which you are using the country, as it were, to solve the internal problems of the Unionist Party?
Not really. I think what we're trying to solve is the problems of Northern Ireland by going to the country, and I don't see that we had any alternative than the action which we took.
There's been, as you say, a state of crisis here, an upheaval, certainly for the last 4 years. Do you envisage, how can it possibly stop? I mean, how will there be important enough differences in the future that will make it different from the past?
Well, I had a choice, didn't I, when I took this job on, either to do absolutely nothing and stay in power indefinitely, into the way Northern Ireland politics runs, which of course would have been far the easiest one for me personally, or else to head an administration which was going to carry out reforms of various kinds and try and have modern industrialization and so on. I chose the second course, and the second course was bound to be a very stony road, and this is the road along which we have been walking and along which I continue to intend to walk.